Today, when you make a call on a cell phone, that call typically goes wirelessly to a cell tower through a wired fiber optic network, and then wirelessly again to your recipient. We don't think much about this. It just happens. But what if I told you that only 60 years ago, this connection mechanism was almost reversed? 60 years ago, you would have most likely made your call on a landline phone connected via a copper network. This call, if long distance at least, would then go over a wireless radio network, tower to tower, across the country. Each tower to tower link would be carrying up to thousands of phone calls and several TV broadcasts as well. But these broadcasts weren't meant for you and me to watch. They were being sent to numerous ABC, NBC, and CBS affiliates in cities across the nation. These transmissions were at radio frequencies so high at the time that no consumer equipment could tune in. And the beams were so tightly aimed that they would have been hard to pick up anyways. Today we're talking about AT&T Long Lines, the forgotten network that connected the country before the internet. So the question is, why would you use wireless radio links instead of wires to get communications across the country? And the answer is, of course, complicated. In the early days of telegraphy and telephony, experimentation occurred with both wires and radio. Wires obviously presented a challenge, as you needed extremely long cables to span distances. How else would one get a call from New York to California, or even more challenging, New York to London? Early pioneers of radio discovered that radio waves would bounce off the atmosphere and allow for communicating over these long distances without the wire. Service between New York and London began in 1928. The problem, though, is that these radio waves were hard to control. Certain frequencies would work better during the day, others better at night, and sometimes atmospheric conditions would prevent them from working at all. Furthermore, the range of radio frequencies that will bounce off the atmosphere is very small compared to the range of frequencies used today. And since the radio waves went everywhere, frequencies were hard to reuse. So this left room for very few calls. And naturally, telephone companies charged top dollar for this new service. Thus, due to the limitation of radio, wires were still widely used. AT&T strung and buried hundreds of thousands of miles of wire and cable. But initially, each pair of wires could only carry one call. Technology came out to use frequency division multiplexing to place 16 calls on the same wire pair, but it was clear that this couldn't be increased forever. And over long distances, a pair of electrical conductors has less bandwidth than even the radio frequencies that will bounce off the atmosphere. So you'd still need a lot of wire. Furthermore, TV was getting big in the 40s. Network television required broadcasts to be delivered from a hub city, like New York, across the country. And video signals require a lot more bandwidth than a phone call. Video signals had so much bandwidth that they required coaxial cables to go any reasonable distance. In fact, each coaxial tube inside this larger cable could only carry one TV program. And a cable that weighs over 5 pounds per foot costs a lot of money to run thousands of miles. Furthermore, this 4,000-mile cable required 950 electrically powered amplification stations, or about one every 4 miles. So it was clear that something better was needed. Scientists and engineers had discovered that higher radio frequencies behaved more predictably and could be directed into narrow beams with shaped metallic antenna elements. These frequency bands could carry multiple TV channels and thousands of phone calls, all without the wires. You only needed a repeater station about once every 30 miles, as the signals would not go over the horizon. The challenge was making the electronics that could produce and handle these frequencies. Vacuum tubes were the device of choice at the time, as semiconductor devices were only in their infancy. Bell Labs hacked at this problem, and in 1945 managed to set up a successful experimental link between New York City and Boston. The link showed so much promise that only 2 years later, the FCC gave AT&T a license to deploy this network across the nation. For logistical reasons, the band was shifted down a bit from the experimental band used. At the time, many frequencies were being tested, and the FCC understood how important spectrum planning was about to become. So in 1947, 3.7 to 4.2 gigahertz was given to AT&T to build out their network. Cutting-edge technology was required for these frequencies at the time. These frequencies are technically known as microwave and operate at an even higher frequency than your microwave oven. The first commercially deployed version of this network was known as TD2 and used 6 10 MHz wide channels spaced across the allocation. Note all the space between the channels and the amount of unused space. This is because radio filtering technology was much more primitive back then. The system required wide channel spacing to work well. A channel could carry either one television broadcast or 480 phone calls. AT&T built these communication sites to be hardened, since this was all being built out during the Cold War. They had generators for backup power. Many sites had incinerator toilets if you were stuck late on the job or shitting a brick during the apocalypse. One site I was at had this nice outhouse too, where you could sit next to a friend. And many reportedly had bunkers, 30-day food supplies, radiation detection equipment, and HVAC equipment designed to mitigate radiation and shockwave exposure in the case of an attack. Now, getting back to the technology, AT&T and Bell Labs rapidly improved the system in the early 50s. Consumable components, such as vacuum tubes, were replaced with better designs to increase longevity. By 1951, the development of slot filters using ferrite cores allowed the number of channels to be nearly doubled. A few years later, Bell Labs began working on a newer technology called TH, which would operate in the 6 GHz band. This new technology had twice the number of channels as TD2, and could carry 1,200 calls per channel. Advancements in antenna encoding technology allowed them to cram more than 4 times the amount of data into the same 500 MHz bandwidth as TD2. The challenge was creating an antenna that could support both TD2 and TH at the same time. This issue was solved in 1955, and the new antennas started to roll out. However, with the new antennas, AT&T realized that they could upgrade the TD2 system first. They managed to add more channels to TD2 and get up to 600 calls per channel with new multiplexer technology. TH was thus put on the back burner until 1961, when AT&T began to roll it out. In 1962, AT&T and Bell Labs decided it was time to overhaul the TD2 system. They would replace the klystron tube in the transmitter with a lower noise traveling wave tube. Furthermore, all other vacuum tubes in the system would be replaced with solid-state electronics, and the receiver would be improved with newer diode technology. The new revision would be TD3. Improvements to the antennas and physical plant would also be made, allowing the number of calls per channel to be increased once again to 1,200. AT&T found that just the antenna and plant improvements allowed the number of calls to be increased to 900, and termed this revision TD2A. They quickly began to roll out this capacity increase before TD3 arrived. By 1968, it was estimated that 40% of long-distance calls and 95% of intercity television programs were being carried over the AT&T Long Lines microwave network. In the 1970s, the gallium arsenide field effect transistor, or GasFET, was developed at Bell Labs and became the first semiconductor device to be economically viable for the final amplification stage at 4 GHz. Consequently, in the early 80s, AT&T replaced every remaining vacuum tube amplifier with the more reliable semiconductor-based devices. So, what happened? Well, other technologies caught up. Satellites allowed TV broadcasts to be delivered across the continent without a complex microwave repeater network. Fiber optic technology eventually improved to the point where it had much more capacity for calling and data than the microwave network. Even AT&T stopped expanding their microwave network in the 1970s, as they began to focus on fiber. And in the 1990s, the Long Lines microwave network went dark. AT&T sold off all the towers in 1999. Some were purchased by cell tower companies like American Tower and have been repurposed. Some went unpurchased and now stand derelict. Some were torn down. and some even still have the old microwave equipment inside. And a select few, between New York City and Chicago, are still being used as microwave relays, albeit with new equipment. Microwave transmission provides slightly lower latency over the same distance compared to fiber optics, making it a potentially useful technology for real-time applications like high-frequency trading. The AT&T Long Lines towers and bunkers built during the Cold War era are a fascinating piece of urban lore. While this technology stands derelict, if it's even still standing, the technologies developed by Bell Labs live on in everything we use today. In fact, the frequencies used by the TD2 system can now be produced by your 5G cell phone.